Hello, and welcome to this episode of our Active Motif webinar series. My name is Mason Brooks, and today we'll be hearing from my colleague, Dr. Michael Garbati. He's a technical support scientist here at Active Motif, and today Michael will be talking about ways to ensure success and get the best results possible from your ChIP-Seq experiments.
Thank you, Mason, for the introduction. Today I'm going to talk about chromatin immunoprecipitation. Chromatin immunoprecipitation, or ChIP, identifies regions of the genome bound to specific transcription factors, cofactors, or it identifies where histone modifications are in the genome. The first step, we start by formaldehyde fixing cells. What this does is creates crosslinks between the genomic DNA and the bound proteins. Next, we isolate the chromatin and sonicate. This chops up the genomic DNA into smaller fragments. The third step is we use an antibody to immunoprecipitate that DNA by using ChIP-validated antibodies that are against the protein of interest or the histone modification of interest. Next, we reverse crosslinks. We purify the DNA, and we either perform next-gen sequencing or quantitative PCR to identify what were those sequences enriched by the protein of interest. So all of these steps present specific challenges, and this is why ChIP has always been seen as a very challenging technique. But here at Active Motif, we have specific solutions to these problems that most researchers have with chromatin IP. First of all, a lot of ChIP reactions are performed on very difficult samples or limited samples. Either you want to use primary cells from which you can only get a few cells, limiting the amount of protein that you can immunoprecipitate from. Frozen tissue presents some challenges. Formaldehyde fixed paraffin embedded tissue blocks presents a lot of challenges. We have solutions to address those challenges. Also, the IP conditions. A lot of times the ChIP buffer or the wash buffer is either too stringent or non-stringent enough. This can result in a lot of background or just not getting any DNA from your ChIP reaction. We have the ChIP-validated antibodies to address those problems. We have ChIP kits with optimized buffer systems and wash buffers to solve the problems of not having enough stringency with your immunoprecipitation or your washes. So our kits address these problems of having limited cells, getting chromatin from challenging tissue types or tissue sources like FFPE blocks. And we also have a specific kit for not having access to a sonicator. So the solutions are, we have the ChIP at high sensitivity kit. We have the low cell ChIP-Seq kit. These two kits specifically can yield reproducible results from very challenging samples and low input. We have our FFPE ChIP-Seq kit that is specifically designed for getting reproducible results from formalin fixed paraffin embedded blocks. We have our ChIP-It Express enzymatic kit. This kit uses an enzymatic shearing cocktail rather than a sonication-based chromatin shearing method to allow you to perform a ChIP assay in a laboratory that doesn't have access to a sonicator. These are just a few of the specialized chromatin IP kits that Active Motif offers. These kits are built with IP buffers and wash buffers that are optimized to preserve those antibody-antigen interactions. Another step in ChIP that presents unique challenges is sonication. A lot of times ChIP assays fail because your sonication was inconsistent. Inconsistent shearing sometimes leads to foaming samples. if you accidentally touch the probe of the sonicator to the side of the tube, there's cooling issues with keeping your samples always at 4 degrees, whereas sonication tends to heat up your samples. All of these problems and issues with sonication can lead to inconsistent results and sometimes failed experiments. So Active Motif has a solution for this issue. We now have our PIXUL multi-sample sonicator. It can present you with simple, rapid, and extremely consistent shearing of chromatin, DNA, RNA, or protein. It's really easy to use. It has a touch screen in which you can select up to 12 different protocols or conditions for each run. So you load a 96 well plate so you can sonicate up to 96 samples at once. And the way it works is just like a PCR machine where you put in your sonication parameters, you input which columns get which parameters, and the machine will then run through that program using its own cooling buffers to keep your samples at a low temperature and to perform the sonication without the need to go into the cold room and put on the headphones and worry about that probe sonicator touching your tube. So one of the benefits of PIXUL is that you get highly consistent shearing. You get to sonicate up to 96 wells at a time. The coupling fluid cools in 15 minutes. The consumables are really inexpensive. You can perform the shearing in the same 96 well plate that you cultured your cells in. And these plates are not proprietary, they're readily available. So this solves shearing bottlenecks in NGS applications. The PIXUL provides the flexibility to process multiple sample types on a single plate because you can select 12 different protocols at once. And all of this taken together avoids the transfer steps and potential loss of sample, being able to perform this in the same plate that you culture the cells in. So for more on our PIXUL and how this sonication system works, please watch this space for my colleague Rick Sen's talk, where he provides a lot of detail about how the PIXUL works. So another step that I touched upon earlier in my summary of the CHIP protocol is the choice of antibody. Not every antibody that works in Western blots and immunoprecipitations works in chromatin immunoprecipitation. So the choice of the antibody is critical, and you can save a lot of time by choosing one of our CHIP-validated antibodies. Active Motif offers over 250 in-house CHIP-validated antibodies that are against histone modifications. The readers, the writers, and the erasers of these histone modifications, they're against transcription factors, and we have antibodies against RNA polymerase II and phospho-RNA Pol II. A lot of these CHIP-validated antibodies, over 90, are recombinants. These are Abflex recombinant antibodies. Now, the advantage to a recombinant antibody is that it solves the problem of reproducibility. When a lot of a polyclonal antibody that worked well for you runs out, you can use the same antigen to create a new lot from a different rabbit, but it's not guaranteed that that antibody will work the same. Having a recombinant guarantees that each time you do a CHIP, whether it be this year or 5 years from now, if you use the recombinant antibody, you'll get the same results. So another challenge is choosing the right CHIP controls. We always perform input controls, and sometimes we perform spike-in normalization. So let's define input controls. An input is sequencing the DNA before the immunoprecipitation. So this is after the sonication and before the IP. It should be just next-gen sequencing of all the genomic DNA. If you have similar sample types, you can do a pooled input And if you have very different sample types, maybe a wide range of patient samples or comparing different tissue types, we recommend doing individual input controls for each CHIP reaction. So what we mean by a pooled input is that if you have the same cell type but want to CHIP several different targets, or if you have very similar cell types to CHIP the same target, what you can do is pool together an aliquot of each one of those samples before the CHIP and perform one NGS reaction on that pooled input so that you can compare your CHIP results all to that same input sample. And performing different sample types forces you to only compare each CHIP reaction result to its own input. Another control that you may want to consider, especially when choosing samples that have been treated with some epigenetic inhibitor, is our spike in normalization. So this is Drosophila chromatin, a trace amount of Drosophila chromatin that is added to your human chromatin or whichever chromatin sample you're studying. It's added to that well or that tube along with an antibody that will pull down that Drosophila chromatin. And this would be our spike in antibody that is Drosophila specific. What it's meant to be is a side reaction that is going on at the same time and in the same tube as your test reaction. It's an internal control. So for this example, where a sample has been treated with an epigenetic inhibitor, and then we performed chromatin immunoprecipitation against H3K27 trimethyl, we see that in the DMSO-treated samples, there was a lot more chromatin pulled down. So the epigenetic inhibitor lowered the amount of trimethylation at H3K27. But if we didn't use spike-in, we may lose that quantitative difference. And I'll show you how in the next steps. So once we perform an NGS library prep, that library is amplified. And so after the amplification, as you can see from these blue sequences, we may already be losing that difference, that quantitative difference of H3K27. That's a real biological result. However, as we can see, this spiked in Drosophila chromatin was also amplified more because it represented a greater percentage of the chromatin that was in that tube. So we can then go back and normalize the amount of H3K27 trimethyl reads to the amount of Drosophila reads. So this control is sort of like a loading control. So taking a look at the results, if we never did the spike in normalization, the H3K27 reads look pretty much the same between DMSO and the epigenetic inhibitor, even though we know that inhibitor lowered the amount of reads. It didn't affect where trimethylation was located, but it affected the amount of trimethylation. And that difference is revealed by the spike in normalization. So especially for experiments like this, where you have treatment with an epigenetic inhibitor, and we recommend it for all H3K27 trimethyl CHIP experiments, we recommend doing this internal control. It really preserves the biology, and you can see where there was a quantitative difference in the amount of either methylation loss or gain. And I'm going to close by talking about bioinformatics. Now, this is another challenge of CHIP assays, is how do we analyze the data that we get off the sequencer? Annotation of the raw data file, visualization of the peaks, these require the expertise in bioinformatics, and we can provide that for you. Active Motif offers a service where we perform the entire CHIP assay. we incorporate the quality control steps as well to ensure the highest quality of data delivered. So we ask for you to fix your cells and send them to us as fixed pellets overnight on dry ice. We then prepare the chromatin and sonicate. The chromatin prep is quantified, and we look at the shearing profile to make sure it's the right size. We perform the ChIP reaction with a ChIP-validated antibody that is qualified prior to the ChIP-Seq. We construct the library and QC it by PCR. We perform sequencing to a read depth of about 30 million reads. From that, we can generate a minimum of 10 million unique sequence tags. So what you get in the results is a raw data file, annotated and indexed BAM files, bigwig peak visualization files, motif analysis, and several figures, so that on the day that you download the data from our FTP server, you can be looking at figures that really show the differences between your different ChIP reactions, and you can look at meaningful results without having to perform all of these dry lab bioinformatic steps in your laboratory yourself. So thanks a lot for your attention. You can learn more about our bioinformatics pipeline by paying attention to the next seminar in this series from Steve Stellman, where he goes into a bit more detail on how bioinformatics processing works. If you have additional questions on this talk, you can contact me at tech_service@activemotif.com. And please visit our website for additional information about all the products and services that I mentioned today. Thank you.